Hello everyone, welcome to the world of software testing. So in this lecture, let's take a brief overview of test case design and test case execution with an example. So just to get a basic idea on the test cases part. So the test case is defined as a group of conditions under which a tester determines whether the software application is working as per the client requirements or expectations or not. So the test case design includes preconditions, the test case name or test ID, input conditions, and the expected results. So basically, the test case defines the client requirements or expectations, and it includes preconditions, input conditions, the test case ID, and the expected results. The expected result basically comes from the client requirements or expectations. So before going for the test case execution, we need to first design the test cases based on the client requirements. So again, to design any test cases, test engineer has to find out all the possible scenarios based on the functionality to be tested. So once all the scenarios are found out, then we can go for the test case design. So let's say, for example, if you want to design the test cases for the Gmail login functionality. So for the login functionality, we need to have an input as a username and the password here. So this is a username, and then if you click on the next, it will ask for a password. So we need to provide these two inputs to the application, then only it will get login. So as I mentioned, this is a basic overview of the test case design. We'll not discuss about any test case design techniques in this lecture. So we'll cover them all in the upcoming lectures in more detail. So let's consider this login functionality for now. So to understand in a better way, consider some scenarios for the login functionality. So I have mentioned here four scenarios for the login functionality here for the username and password. So before going for the test case design, first the test engineer has to identify all the possible test scenarios for the particular functionalities under test. So here I have identified four scenarios. First is verify that user should be able to log in with valid username and valid password. So here this scenario is for the username and password. So first case, it is valid username and valid password. The second thing is verify that user should not be able to log in with a valid username and invalid password. So if we are giving the valid username and invalid password, then it will not get login. Then the third scenario is verify that user should not be able to log in with an invalid username and valid password. So we are doing a reverse here. We are providing the invalid username and valid password. And the last one is verify that user should not be able to log in with invalid username and invalid password. So both are invalid. So user should not be able to log in with a invalid username and invalid password. So these are the four scenarios we have identified. So now based on this test scenario identified, we can write the test cases for these four scenarios. So this is a test design, simple example. So in this, we have some certain columns here. So this is a fixed format every organization is using. So the first column here is a test scenario. So whatever the identified scenarios are there, we are writing the test cases for those scenarios. Then the second column is a step name. So here we can mention step 1, step 2, step 3 in a sequential manner just to identify the step number. The third column is for the design step. So this is nothing but a steps to navigate to the particular functionality. And then the expected result. So for each of the design step written, there is the expected result. So this is mentioned in the client requirements or expectations. And then the actual result. So this we will get at the time of test case execution. So actual execution will give this actual result. So first we have written here, verify that user should be able to log in with a valid username and valid password. So again, if we are providing the valid username and valid password, then definitely user should be able to log into the application. So now we need to check this scenario here. So these are the design steps. So first design step is, this is step number 1. So what we need to do is we need to go to the browser, launch the browser, then enter the URL for the gmail.com, and then it will open the home page. So again, the expected result should be it should open the Gmail home page, should get opened successfully here. Then click on the login model, then login model home page should get opened successfully. Then enter the valid username. So if you are providing the valid username, it should get accepted on the login page. Then click on the next button, and then page should get navigated to the next page, which will allow us to enter the password. Then the step 5 is enter the valid password. So again, if you are providing the valid password, it should get accepted. So password should get accepted on the login page. So whatever the expected result is, we need to enter in the expected result column. And then the last step, that is step number 6, is click on the next button. So clicking on next button means user should be logged in successfully. So these are the steps for this particular scenario. And then here the actual result will get on the actual execution. So we have considered two scenarios here for now, just for the understanding purpose. The second scenario is verify that user should not be able to log in with a valid username and invalid password. Now we are providing invalid password input to the application. So again, same steps, launch the browser and enter the URL gmail.com. Then Gmail homepage should get opened successfully. Then step 2 is login module. Click on the login module. The login module homepage should get opened successfully. Then enter a valid username. So username should get accepted on the login page. As it is valid in username, then only it should get accepted. Then click on the next button. So again, page should get navigated to the next page, which will allow us to enter the password. So now here the steps 5 is enter the invalid password. So we are providing the invalid password here. So if you are providing invalid password, then password should not get accepted on a login page, and error message should get displayed as a wrong password. Try again or click forgot password to reset it. So this is depending upon the expectations we have. So accordingly, the message should get displayed for the invalid password. So we can have two more cases as well, that is invalid username and invalid password. Then invalid username and valid password, those four conditions we can write the test cases. So this is the way we can write the test cases. So this is the standard format, and this will vary in the columns to column by a particular organization which format they are using, but these are the common steps which will be there in that document. Then once the test case design is completed, then there comes a test case execution part. So once all the scenarios are identified and test cases are designed for those, the test engineer can right away start testing once he receives the build from the developers. So as we have mentioned in the earlier tutorials, like tester gets the build from the developer side, and then test engine then can start the testing on that particular build. So the test case execution is nothing but following all the steps mentioned in the test case and try executing those on the application. And then here the actual responsibility of test engineer to check if the actual results are matching with the expected results or not. So this is the execution part. Then next, when we can say that the test case is passed or failed. So let's say if we have executed the test steps and all the actual results for all the steps are matching with the expected result mentioned in the test design, then we can say that test is passed. So if we go back here, so now I can say these are total 7 steps here, and then for each of the design steps there is a expected results again for the 6 steps. So if all these 6 steps are matching with the expected results, so whatever the actual results we are getting with these design steps, that should get matched with the expected result. If it is matching, then we can say that the test is passed. Let's say if we consider the step 2 is not working, and if it is not matching with the expected result, then we can say that it is failed. So also, if all the steps are not working as expected, then we can say that test is failed. So all these actual results coming from these design steps should get matched with the expected results. Then and then we can say that test is passed. So here, if some of the actual results of all the actual results are not matching with the expected results, if some of the actual results or all of the actual results are not matching with the expected results mentioned in the test case design, then we can say that test is failed. Those we need to report to the developers and then get it fixed and retested. So now, do testers start the testing after coding or before coding? So this is the most important question getting asked in the interviews. So if you consider the SDLC process, when the coding phase is started, in parallel test engineers start designing the test cases. Means once the test engineer receives the build from the developer side, the test engineer must have their test case design ready or complete, and they can right away start testing the software application once they get the build from the developer side. So don't get confused if anyone asks whether coding starts before or testing starts before or after coding. So both coding and test case design or test case execution works in parallel, not design, test case execution works in parallel. So we can say that testing and coding starts in parallel. So thanks for watching this video. Please do subscribe our YouTube channel World of Software Testing for such more videos, and click on the bell icon to get the latest updates. So in the upcoming lectures, we'll dig further into the software testing concepts. So thanks for watching.